this thing out of here. The complaint zapper. Zap away your negativity. Complaint zapper instructions. Do not use if you're pregnant, in a car condition, or wear bracelets. Because I'm good to go tomorrow. Don't to test. Hold in front of you and say something negative. And the weather today stinks. Obviously, that's really work. Let's see.
Oh no.
Walk on here, so there we go. This is my new way of life. Goodbye.
Church for a absolutely wonderful day. Thank you for making me feel so welcome and at home today. This is a wonderful church, and I just felt the joy of the Lord in it all day long.
Woo!
And we went and had some Sonny's barbecue. Woo! And I believe that that hog died for a good reason. I tell everybody it entered the ministry. And we went to pastor's house and I laid before the Lord. And yes, I snored. But I had such a good, relaxing time. And this is the first time I've really got to be around Brother and Sister Creasy for any amount of time. Saw him at state functions. But I can already tell you that I love and appreciate them. And like Arnold Schwarzenegger, I'll be back in September. I'm coming back to do a ladies' so some of y'all didn't get a CD this morning, so I'll bring some more with me next September, this coming September, 4 months from now. And hopefully you will be delivered by that time, sister. I think she's going to have a 4th of July baby myself, but anyways. Over in the book of Numbers, chapter 11, verse 1. And when the people, everybody say complain. It displeased the Lord. Jumping ahead of me, girlfriend, you're giving me a heart attack up here.
I use that verse a lot.
There may be a reason the Lord put this message on my heart, okay? To reconfirm it with you. And when the people complained, it displeased the Lord. And the Lord heard it. Now I want to tell you something. You don't want to make a habit out of displeasing the Lord.
Amen.
Because when you do, the Lord hears every word that is spoken.
Amen.
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 The Lord heard it, and his anger was kindled, and the fire of the Lord burnt among them and consumed them that were in the uttermost part of the camp.
Mm.
Now, how different do you think that our life would be if we really considered that the Lord would send down fire from heaven and burn us? Amen.
Amen.
If we really believed that he would do that, I think we would think twice before we speak.
Amen. Amen.
Being burnt with fire is worse than being zapped by a complaint zapper.
Amen.
Much more. I wonder how many times in one day we would be zapped if we wore a complaint zapper.
Ooh.
Amen.
Amen.
Get out of the way! Can that waitress get any slower? Why can't you ever do anything right? I mean, we'd just be electrocuted. I would be electrocuted in one day. The message is too long. Not.
Amen.
These people had no cause for murmuring. Number one, God was among them.
Right.
He supplied all of their needs.
Right.
He was doing miracles in their midst daily. Mm. And he was continually showing them kindness in their behalf.
Amen.
Now, God became frustrated towards them because he was doing great acts of kindness to them, and all he got in return was murmuring and complaining. That's why he sent the fire.
Right.
And how would you feel if you were always doing acts of kindness to someone and all they did was murmur and complain to you?
Right.
Amen. Some of you husbands need to go home tonight and say, honey, thank you for every meal you cook me.
Amen.
And if he is the sole breadwinner, then you need to say, and thank you, honey, for bringing home the bacon that I could fry it up. Amen. And make you feel like a man. Come on. You can bring home the bacon. Okay, we're not going to leave that soon. I can just hear the people in their tents as you're going to Numbers 14. I can hear them in their tents as they are complaining against Moses. Can't you just hear them? Oh, Moses. He thinks he's all that and a bag of chips. Oh, Moses. He's been to the mountaintop with God. Ooh, Moses. He's just all that. And they just murmured and complained. Until God just burnt their tents down. Everybody say, no murmuring in your tents.
No murmuring in your tents.
Now, God asked Moses a question, Numbers 14:27. He asked them this question. How long shall I bear with this evil congregation which murmur against me? I have heard their murmurings of the children of Israel, which they murmur against me. Now, God's really upset when he uses the word murmur three times in one verse. Amen. They murmured about not having enough food, so God sent them down some manna. They got to murmuring about the manna. They wanted some meat, so he rained down quail knee-deep.
Right.
Oh, I love quail.
Mm.
And he rained down quail, and they became so gluttonous that they ate quail. The Bible said they ate quail until it came out their nose. You can't make this stuff up. It's in the Bible. I'm reading that. Came out their nostrils. Now that's just, you know, too much information. But the Bible puts it all in there. And he said that they ate it until it came out their nostrils. Then they complained about the quail. God said, because you complained against me, none of you that are 20 years of age, older, will be able to go into the land promised.
Mm.
I want you to think about that for a minute. Mercy. As you're going to Matthew, the 12th chapter. Mm. And I wondered why he chose the age 20. Only 20 and under would get to go into the land of promise.
Right.
And I got to thinking about it, and I came up with my own idea on it. It's not biblical, it's just my thought. I think that the reason he said 20 and under is those children hadn't learned how to complain real good like their mom and dads had. I told you it was just a thought. And here we have those that are over the age of 20, they can't go into the promised land because of their murmuring and their complaining against God. Now, I want to ask you, how important do you think that it is not to murmur and complain?
Ooh.
I would hate to miss heaven over murmuring and complaining.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
And I love kids. I could just put them in a bowl and eat them up. I just love kids. I love young people. I love being around young people. It's just those old grouchy people that I stay away from.
Amen.
You know, if you're old and grouchy, I just kind of just, you know, veer away from you. Just, how you doing? It's good, I guess. And, you know, I just love children. Now, sometimes older people get upset and they say and they do things. And they need to realize that the children are watching. Now, don't make me raise my sign.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I think we need to read some scripture right now.
Amen.
Matthew, the 12th chapter, verses 34 through 37. Now, this is Jesus speaking. A lot of people won't accept it unless it's in red. So accept this. Old generations of vipers, Jesus calling you a snake. Oh my goodness, I'm not mean enough to do that. Jesus said, oh generation of vipers, how long can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things. And an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy
words
thou shalt be condemned.
Amen.
Now you could be going to Philippians, the fourth chapter. Now you see, he's saying here, out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. Some people have a big heart. You thought I was going to say something else, didn't you?
Amen.
Some people have a big heart, and it just flows constantly. And he said, you better be careful with this. Because all of the idle words that you say are going to be taken into account on the day of judgment.
Right.
Have you ever said anything or said something that you wished you had not?
Right. Yes.
I don't want to go down alone, people. Come on now.
Yes. Yep.
Thank you. I feel better now. We all in the same boat.
Yes.
Said something you thought, oh, I wish I hadn't said that. And the person you said it to said, I will make you sorry you did say that. And they do. Words are kind of curious. Once they're out there, you can't jerk them back.
Right.
It's not a blackboard. You can't erase it. It is forever on the person's mind. But I will reiterate this morning's message. If somebody has said things to you in the past that hurt you, that wounded your spirit, you've got to turn it loose and let it go.
Amen.
Amen. That's your responsibility. Don't keep punishing somebody for the things in the past. Honey, this is the present.
Right.
This is where we are now. And you will never, ever fulfill your present if you keep living in your past.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So watch your words. Philippians 4, 6 through 8. Y'all, I'm so sorry. My throat is like it is, but it is what it is. And this sinus infection will be gone Sunday.
Bless her, Lord.
Amen.
And until then, I'll continue to take drugs. But anyway, Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 through 8. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with what?
Thanksgiving.
Let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall maintain your heart and your minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, what did the Bible say to do?
Think on these things.
So see right there, he gave you a list of the things that we are to think on. The things that are true, honest, just, pure, lovely, and of a good report.
Amen.
Every day it would be good, I wrote down, to confess all the things that you desire from the Lord. Yes. Salvation for your loved ones. Health and prosperity for you and your loved ones, not only in your prayer, but also with your voice. Speak out as you think on these things.
Right.
Now, I wrote down a good prayer for us to pray. And it would be, for the glory of God the Father and my Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, I say that my children are mighty men and women of God. I say that my grandchildren are mighty men and women of God.
That's right.
Joy and gladness fills my heart, soul, coming in.
Yes.
I am blessed going out.
Woo!
I am the head.
Yes.
And I am not the tail.
Right.
Hallelujah. The Bible is a legal document, and it is sealed by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Right.
Yes. By believing and confessing the Word of God, then the Word becomes a reality.
Yes.
Right. That's right.
Amen. Speaking daily that I will let no corrupt word or any corrupt communication
right.
come out of my mouth,
right.
but that which is to the edifying
yes.
of the Lord.
Come on.
Yes.
Come on.
I'll read that to you in Ephesians, the fourth chapter. Ephesians 4, 29 through 32.
Bless her, Lord. Bless her.
Starts right out. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth.
Right.
But that which is good to the use of, everybody say edifying.
Edifying.
That it may minister grace unto the hearers.
Amen.
And listen very carefully to verse 30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption.
Yes.
When we speak hurtful words, or we murmur, or we complain, do you know that it grieves the Holy Spirit of God?
Right.
I just read it to you.
Right.
Verse 31, 32, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye what?
Kind.
Kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you.
Amen.
I want to ask you a question. Do you edify or do you crucify? Your words do one of the other. They edify or they crucify. We are in a time when people are in need of blessings.
That's right.
One discouraged woman said, what I need is a blessing that isn't in disguise. Amen. We need to encourage one another. We need to edify one another. We need to lift each other up. There is a tendency, and I always say this, and I forgot to say it this morning. I got here at church at 10:30 because my GPS got me lost, but I didn't have time to talk with pastor and wife, and please let me make this clear to you, and you that I have held revivals for, you know this is truth. I don't want to hear anything. The pastor and his wife, they don't tell me anything because I want to preach from inspiration and not information. Amen. So anything that I said this morning was not forewarned by the pastor. It came from God. Anything I say tonight is coming from God. Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
But there are times there is a tendency to become so familiar with people, whether it be your friend, your companion, your pastor, or another church leader, that negative words can be spoken about them and harm can be done.
Amen.
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 Right.
We need to consider the consequences of doing such things. There have been times that people have gone home on a Sunday morning, Sunday afternoon.
Right.
And they're sitting around the table, and they're having the pastor for dinner, and he ain't even there.
Oh, wow.
Chewing him up and spitting him out.
Right. That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, if he just do this, if he just do that. One couple was driving home from church, and the man said the message was too long. And his wife said, yeah. And the singing was too loud. And their little 5-year-old boy in the back seat said, but it was a pretty good show for a quarter, don't you think? Sheila. That word means think on it. The consequences of speaking against your pastor in the presence of your children, this is what happens. And I know this church doesn't do this. I'm just warning you against it.
Amen.
When you speak against your pastor or another leader, what you are doing is you are causing that child to lose respect
right. For
that pastor
right. And
to lose confidence
mm-hmm. For
that pastor.
That's right.
Now, whenever they grow up and they get in the teen years, and them children become a thorn in your flesh, and you run to pastor. Pastor, can you please help Johnny? Pastor is going to just have to look at you and say, I can't. You've already destroyed my confidence in that child.
Amen.
There's nothing I can do or say to help that child. I can pray for that child.
Right.
But you have all, I knew the day that you did it because the child wouldn't even shake my hand.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Be careful.
That's right.
Of your murmuring and your complaining, because it will displease God.
Amen.
And He will rain down upon you.
Amen.
And not in the way that you would want Him to. Amen.
Amen.
God is not going to answer your needs, and He is not going to bless you
right. While
you are busy blessing other people out.
Oh, right.
Amen. Everybody say, no murmuring in your tents.
No murmuring in your tents.
All right, here's the speech test. You that are writers, write this down. Whenever you are tempted to express something about someone, and it could be negative, hurtful, gossip, or meaningless talk, you got to ask yourself these three questions. And this is what I want you to ask yourself. As Junior is going to Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter, ask yourself these three questions. Is it true? Is it edifying?
Right.
And is it necessary?
Right.
Now, in these three questions, you can say, is it true? Yeah, it's true. And if it's true, it ain't gossip.
Right.
If it's true, it ain't gossip.
Right.
Oh, but I beg to differ with you. Is it true? Can't stop there. Might be true, but is it edifying?
Ooh.
That'll put a lot of it to rest.
Right.
And what that won't put to rest, this will, is it really necessary?
That's right. Amen.
Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter, verse 14 through 16. But the word is very nigh unto thee. In other words, it's close to you, in your mouth and in thy heart, that thou mayest do it. See? I have set before thee this day life and good, death and evil, in that I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in His ways, and to keep His commandments and His statutes and His judgments, that thou mayest what?
Live
and multiply. And the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess.
Yes.
Now, listen close to verse 19 and 20. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death,
right,
blessing and cursing. Therefore, he said, choose what?
Life.
Life.
Choose life, that both thou and thy seed may what?
Live.
Live. That thou mayest love the Lord thy God, and that thou mayest obey His voice, and that thou mayest cleave unto him, for he is thy life and the length of thy days. There it is.
Right.
A choice for you, and you're the only one that can make that choice.
Amen.
Yeah. Now, if Jesus came in a physical form, more physical than he is in me right now, if he stood before you like you think he looks, and he came to you, and he said, I'm going to give you a choice tonight, life or death.
Right.
How many here would choose life?
That's right.
Amen.
And I'm going to give you another choice, blessing or cursing. Hello, I'm in for the blessing.
Amen.
Amen. But you are already in for the cursing if you don't tithe.
Ooh.
That ain't part of my message, but I can tell you right now, Malachi tells you that if you don't give God his 10%, his, it's not yours, it's his. If you don't give God his 10%, you've got a curse on you.
Right.
Now, how many want to choose blessing and how many want to choose curse? I'm going for the blessing.
Come on.
Amen.
It's a choice. Proverbs, we know this verse by heart. Proverbs 18 and 21, death and life are in the power of the tongue.
Right.
Death and life are in the power of the tongue. I've often said this, there have been more people killed with the tongue than ever with the gun.
Right, that's right.
That's what the Bible says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. Some folks cannot fast because of their health. We just came through January. Of the 3 weeks of fasting, some people are diabetic, and some people have other health issues, and some people are just hungry.
Amen.
I can't believe I said that. But some people cannot fast because of health problems. But the Lord, when I studied the scriptures out, the Lord told me that everyone can do this fast. And the Lord said, I want you to tell the church that I call them to a fast of negative words.
Amen.
Amen.
That's good.
It won't hurt your health. It'll really build you up.
Amen.
Because of negative words, families are divided. Friends separated, feelings offended, spirits wounded,
right.
Prayers unanswered,
mm-hmm.
needs unmet,
right.
And healings bypassed because of thoughtless, piercing, critical, negative words.
Mm.
The devil will immediately give you an excuse to use negative words
right.
on this fast. And you want to, is this fast for a week? No. The Lord wants this fast to be for a lifetime.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
A lifetime of negative, it's going to kill some of y'all. A lifetime of negative words. But the devil will give you some excuses of how you can speak negative. Excuse number one. Well, I'm just telling the truth. Well, you need to keep that truth to yourself.
Hey, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Paul wrote to the Ephesians to speak words of love. Remember the speech test. Is it true? Is it edifying? And is it really necessary? Just because it's true doesn't mean it's edifying or necessary.
That's right.
Amen.
That's
right.
So keep it to yourself. Now, there are some spiritual ways that people, that Christians gossip.
Prayer request. Can I pray for you?
This is how it goes. Now, I wouldn't tell you this, but I want you to help me pray, Mom. Please.
Amen.
It was a bubble in you and you had to get it out. And you used prayer as an excuse.
Right.
Now, I would not tell you this, but you're going to find out about it anyway. Well, let them find out about it from somebody else.
Right.
Amen.
Amen. 9 months will usually tell it anyway. You don't even have to open your mouth. I just want to tell you this. This is not going to cause me. You are not contagious, are you? Thank you. But people find what they consider spiritual ways to gossip.
Right. That's right.
And that's all it is. Is it true? Oh, yeah, honey, it's true, all right. But is it edifying? Well, maybe not. Well, then is it really necessary for you to say it? Mm-mm. No. Another way that the devil will tell you, excuse number two, is, well, I'm just speaking my mind. If you're speaking your peace, then you don't need to be sharing a piece of something that you can't afford to get rid of. Y'all read about John Wesley. A woman told him one time, my talent is to speak my mind. He said, well, sister, I don't think God would mind one bit if you just bury that talent. Bury it. Here's excuse number three. Well, you don't know what they did to me. I'll never forgive them.
Ooh.
Well, Ephesians 4:32 said, and be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving
right.
one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you.
Yes.
And the last excuse, number four, why? That's just the way I feel. And I'd be lying to say otherwise.
Right.
All right, well, first of all, if that's the way you feel, pray through. Pray through. I know y'all just want me to really just speak what's on my mind tonight, don't
Amen.
You? I mean, you don't want me to be just mealy-mouthing around. You just want me to tell it like it is, don't you? If that's the way you feel, then pray through. Amen.
Amen.
And secondly, if you can't say anything nice about somebody, don't say anything at all.
That's right.
So will you just try to find something nice about that person over there? I bet you can't find anything nice to say about that person. Well, I heard him whistle one time, and he can really whistle good.
Amen. Amen.
It's a start.
That's right.
So I am challenging you, not just me, but God and the Word of God is challenging us to fast negative words.
Amen. Amen.
Do your very best from this day forward not to utter another negative, unnecessary word. And I believe that this time of fasting our negative words, that God will loose the chains that have people bound, and He will heal wounds that seem to Amen. Be incurable.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. There was a church that fasted negative words, and there was a man there that had contracted cerebral palsy. And during this time of fasting negative words, God healed that man of cerebral palsy, and the church
Amen.
Said it was in due to the part of fasting their negative words.
Amen.
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 If every time you said a negative word, you knew that it blocked the blessings of God, would you stop negative speaking?
Right.
If you got serious enough that you wanted to see one of your loved ones or a friend saved or somebody healed, would you just stop the negative words?
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Now tonight after church, if you go to a restaurant or you just on your way home, it's going to be a very silent conversation. I just thought of that. How do you fast negative words? Well, when you hear gossip or any negative talk, don't repeat it.
Amen. Amen.
Don't repeat it. Well, if it's true, it ain't gossip. I'm sorry. But it's in my message. Before church, they were saying, well, if it's true, it ain't gossip. I said, excuse me, what did you say?
Confirmation.
Well, if it's true, it ain't gossip. I said, oh, hold on to that thought. Have I got a word for you? If it's true, it ain't gossip. That's not true. Gossip, you want to know the definition of gossip? Gossip is anything that has the intent to be negative, slanderous, or hurtful about someone else. That's what gossip is. Furthermore, when somebody starts to gossip to you, walk away and nobody will get hurt.
Amen.
Amen.
If you walk away, you won't be tempted to repeat it.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Tell them you're fasting. And you've heard that old adage, if someone will talk to you about someone else, they will talk to someone else about you.
Amen.
Believe it, it's true.
That's right.
Another way to fast is when you're tempted to complain about something, what you have or what you don't have, or what you can do and what you can't do, where you are or where you're not, be thankful that you're not homeless, jobless, starving, in a hospital, in a war, or gone a week without any money in your pocket. There's a lot to be thankful for, people.
Amen.
Amen. Everybody say, no murmuring in your tents.
No murmuring in your tents.
We need to say nice things to people. Turn to somebody next to you and say, you just look nice tonight. I tell that as a stretch for some of y'all. When you start to complain about someone, to find fault and point out their negative characteristics, then you need to try to think of something good about that person.
Amen.
Amen. If they're having a good hair day, then tell them, you having a good hair day. Look at poor old Brother Gary. He ain't got no hair. You know what I say? Any day that you wake up with hair, it's a good hair day.
Doesn't have a mustache from his ears.
Now, if I didn't love Brother Gary, he wouldn't let me get away with that. But everyone has something positive about them.
That's right. That's right.
Begin building a habit of saying something good to people. Build one another up. 1 Thessalonians 5:11 says to edify one another. Everybody say edify.
Edify.
It'll change your outlook about people.
Right.
And in doing so, it'll change you.
That's right.
If you start making a habit of saying nice things. I love this scripture, Proverbs 26 and 20. When I lived in Northern California, we heated with wood. I mean, that's all we heated with. We had a warm morning stove, and in the wintertime, my daddy would stoke that thing full, and then he'd shut it down. And that wood would keep us warm. And when he'd get up at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning and go to work, he would put more wood in the stove because it had gone down to coals and it needed some more wood
right
on the fire to make it keep burning. Amen. So with that thought in mind, read Proverbs 26 and 20.
Right.
Where no wood is,
the fire goeth out.
There the fire goeth out. So where there is no talebearer, the strife ceases.
Amen.
Amen.
If you don't keep putting wood on the fire will go out.
Amen.
If you will just stop gossiping and telling that story about that person, the strife will cease.
Right.
Amen.
Don't make me raise my son.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you will just stop, then it will die down. My grandmother lived to be 97 years old. She died early because she ate a lot of pork and a lot of eggs. If she hadn't eaten all that, she might have lived longer than 97. I'm not real sure. But Granny had a lot of old sayings. Boy, I'll tell you what, some of them, when I was a kid growing up, I didn't understand a one of them. She'd say, kid, every old bucket sits on its own bottom. Big deal. A bucket sits on its own bottom. What does that mean? Well, child, it means that everybody's responsible for their own actions.
Right.
I said, well, why didn't you just say that, Granny? You have to bring a milk bucket into the picture, you know? She said, well, that's their possum. Let them wool it. How do you wool a possum? What? Granny, what is wooling a possum? She said, well, child, you take a slick limb, and a possum will run in a holler log. Not a hollow, but a holler log. And you take, and that possum's got really thin hair, but it's long. And you stick that slick limb up there, and you begin to turn it. That's called wooling. And that stick takes that hair. I know y'all so interested in this. That stick takes and wraps that hair around until it's got that possum. And that's called wooling the possum. And you pull them out. And I said, but what does it have any spiritual implications? She said, that's their possum. Let it wool. That means that's their problem. Let them take care of it. Don't you jump in and try to help. So why didn't you just say that? You got to talk about who wants a possum in the first place. I certainly, you ain't going to find me out wooling a possum. What I want was a possum. And I said all that to say this. Granny had a crude saying. It's a crude saying, but Granny said it. She said, child, let me tell you something. The more you stir a pile of dog mess, the worse it stinks. She didn't have to explain that one to me. So, Granny, you ever think about writing a book? No, child. I said, it's probably a good thing.
True it is.
But the more you stir stuff, the worse it stinks. Let it die down. Let that fire die down. Amen?
Amen.
Ecclesiastes, the 5th chapter. While you're going there, are you wood for the fire or are you water from the well of living water?
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
Do you help it burn or do you quench it with that spiritual water? Ecclesiastes 5:1-2. Keep thy foot when thou goest to the house of God and be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools. For they consider not that they do evil. Verse 2, everybody say, be not rash with thy mouth.
Be not rash with thy mouth.
Can you believe that's in the Bible? That's in the Bible. Be not rash with thy mouth, and let not thine heart be hasty to utter anything before God. For God is in heaven, and thou upon earth. Therefore, let thy words be how many?
Few.
You know, I love to laugh and I love to joke around, but I can tell you one thing that I don't joke around about. I don't make jokes about the Father, the Son, or the Holy Ghost.
Amen. That's right.
And I don't like to hear jokes about them.
Amen.
They are sacred.
That's right.
And the Bible says when we're uttering that kind of stuff, it is before God and He is taking account. Amen.
Amen.
Everybody say, no murmuring in your tents.
No murmuring in your tents.
So please don't leave here and get in your car. Start to the restaurant. Don't you dare murmur about how long this message was. Don't do that. I'm going to leave you with this verse, Psalms 19:14. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let the words of my mouth and the things that I meditate in my heart, I want them to be acceptable unto you, Lord.
Amen.
I want you to look down upon them, and I want it to be acceptable, because you are my Lord, my strength, and my redeemer.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
How many want to be acceptable before God?
Amen. Amen.
These worship songs that were sang today are heart and mind provoking.
Amen.
I don't want to talk about you like you're not in the room.
Right.
I want to talk to you face to face.
Right. Amen. That's right.
If the things that we would say, if we would realize that God was right there listening, it would stop us. The things that you watch on television that are filthy, if you could just picture Jesus sitting by your side, you would turn it off or turn it to something else.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
Let my life be acceptable, is what that scripture is saying. Unto you. Amen.
Amen.
Would you stand with me?